When I think of a holdover event, you know, it's a like on the Haystack fire. Lightning came through sometime in the first week of June. A fire was reported in the Haystack area, and then they sent resources out to identify it, and they couldn't find it.
My understanding is that it was a lightning fire. And it's an interesting phenomenon because in this case, they actually believe the lightning strike occurred about 7 days before the fire was found. And that it poked around in those duff fuels that hold fire and eventually came out on the 14th.
Sometimes they go out. Those strikes that are reported or smokes that are initially reported, they go out with that moisture that comes in. But other times they just sit kind of underneath the, in those drier fuels underneath a tree, maybe the tree that the lightning struck, or it could be a tree nearby.
It's almost dead certain that the ignition for this fire was lightning. And it was on the southwestern flank.
I think we are still learning a lot about holdover fires. We've always understood that there is this phenomenon. We see it during the fire season, fires that go quiet and we have to leave that for other fires. They come back to life and we have to come back to them. We have situations where a lightning strike, you know, that ignites a fire will hold over for a period of days. We have fires where heavy fuels will burn intensely, and those fires will continue to linger for long periods of time. And we have fires that pass over in these duff fuels and just grab a piece and hold on. It won't go out until we have to dig them out.
I mean, I've definitely worked on many fires that have started from lightning strikes that may have started a week ago or even a couple weeks ago and held over until the temperature has warmed and the conditions have dried out and the smoke has surfaced.
If you go under a spruce tree, particularly black spruce, and even after a nice soaking rain, you go under that tree and you start playing around in the needles and the litter and the organic material that's under that spruce tree, it's pretty dry in there.
Well, here in Alaska, the forests produce needles, they produce vegetation that eventually dies in the fall and falls to the ground. The difference here in Alaska is that it doesn't decompose very rapidly and it builds up over time. And so what you have is a deep fuel bed of decomposing grasses, twigs, needles, leaves, and other materials that are available to burn over a long period of time. The symbiosis between the duff fuels on the ground where these fires live and the spruce trees above them is a key part of how fire spreads in Alaska. These duff fuels burn with intensity and the trees above them get hot and torch and produce embers that carry into new unburned fuels and start new fires. When they become especially intense, they burn as a crown fire. And those crowns spread from one to the next. And those fires burn most rapidly. There's limited ability to control fires when they reach that level of burning intensity.
Fire can still burn uphill if you have topography in the area. Fire can start at the bottom of a hill and burn uphill if the fuels are dry. The wind is definitely a factor, and especially if wind is in alignment with topography, that's often a major factor in either very high or extreme fire behavior.
This fire was wind-driven, and at first the wind drove it somewhat to the north, and the fire spread out a little bit. Then the fire was pushed by another wind toward the east, and then finally the fire was again pushed toward the south by a different wind direction.
The drier the fuels are, the more easily they are likely to burn. And if we have weather forecasts, we can get a sense for what the humidities are in the atmosphere and, you know, what chances of precipitation are, how sunny it is. Those are all things that, how windy it is, those are all things that factor into how quickly fuels dry out.
the sky covers everything because the solar beam is actually heating the material down here, all types of fuel, both dead fuel and live fuel. And that heat is actually allowing the loss of moisture out of that material.
The greater the surface area to volume ratio, the more easily or quickly a fuel dries out. So fine fuels such as grass or needles, that sort of thing, are dry out really quickly because they have a really high surface area to volume ratio. Versus larger fuels like sticks, those take a little bit longer to dry out. Logs have an even lower surface area to volume ratio. We often refer to them in the fire community as 1 hour fuels, 10 hour fuels, 1,000 hour fuels, and that's the time it takes for those fuels to kind of reach their equilibrium moisture content.
So our fire environment is interesting. It's not particularly complex, but it is unique to Alaska. We have a mix of hardwoods and conifers. We have open areas that also are flammable, but the key species, the black spruce, is ready to burn almost from the time the snow leaves until the time it returns. Ultimately, there's a symbiotic relationship between the duff fuel beds underneath and the trees themselves. Either the duff fuel beds push the fire through the spruce crowns, or the spruce crowns pull the fire from the duff fuel beds. These stands of black spruce trees vary widely. That there are some that are very open with very small spindly crown trees, and those areas can burn very readily, but oftentimes it's what's underneath them that carries the fire. As they get maybe more productive, the black spruce get thicker, the crowns get a little bit bigger, and oftentimes they will carry fire themselves. And we end up with a crown fire that burns these areas largely to black. I think the haystack fire represents the initial progression of a wildfire that could become a problem fire in Alaska. It burned 927 acres, but it was stopped really within the first couple of days. If it hadn't been stopped, a fire like this would grow and continue to grow for days, and then even if it is stopped, if we're not able to suppress it at that point, it would find opportunities to grow again. Those fires are the ones that become large, and we have many examples of those fires in the Alaska landscape.